So you've got a cell, which is in a certain information state, and that information state is, I'll go anywhere. Do you want me to play in goal? Do you want me to play up front? I'll play anywhere you like. And then information is infused into that cell, and that information makes it a brain cell or makes it a skin cell, et cetera, et cetera. It is a computer, and if people and medicine realized that and realized, you know, the energetic fields around it, we would transform human healthcare. Because at the moment, we're treating something in terms of mainstream medicine that they don't know how it works and don't know what it is. And it's ever so straightforward and it's very simple.
I love the idea of stem cells being used to regenerate spinal, you know, people with spinal injuries. I love that idea. I love that, you know, they might be able to reverse certain debilitating illnesses. I love all that. But cloning, and maybe it's because I've been, you and I have been hanging around too long, but I know this is true. Cloning leads me to think super armies.
Well, yeah, I mean...
You know, that's the sort of stuff I started to worry about, you know, super cops, super armies.
Yeah, the thing is, knowledge is neutral. It's how you use it that's positive or negative. Same with the media. Nothing negative about a notebook and a pen. Nothing negative about a television camera. Nothing negative about a microphone. It's how you use it. And it's the same with this stem cell understanding, this what they call stem cell technology. You can use it for great benefit if you can heal someone and give them back faculties and stuff that they've lost. Well, what's wrong with that? But it also has the potential to manipulate, and it depends who's got their hands on it and what they're doing. And so, you know, within the genetic structure, the genetic information field is not just what we call physical attributes, it's also mental and emotional attributes, so and responses. So you can manipulate people's perception by manipulating them on this level. So it has such potential for good. But it has fantastic potential for manipulation as well. It's who's got it, who's got their hands on the wheel.
Who's using it? September was a big month. We got blanket coverage. We don't have time to get into that, but someday maybe on the Dot Connect, and you'll get into why the media covers stories in a certain way, because that's fascinating stuff. You've written about it at length anyway. Al-Shabaab Islamic militants took over the Westgate shopping mall in Nairobi, and it was terrible. A lot of people died, 62 civilians were killed and 170 people were injured. Massive story there.
Yeah, and again, when you have researched this for any period of time, whatever the official story is, you put it on the back burner. You say, hold on a second, let's have a look at this. Let's have a look at what really happened. And this is a story, not at the time, but since, in the Daily Mail. And that pattern we were talking about,
don't tell me. No, I've not seen this. Do you want me to guess? Tell me there was some sort of...
The headline, was Kenya Mall Massacre mastermind backed by CIA cash?
This is in the Daily Mail, right?
Disturbing claims by double agent who worked with terror suspect for years. In the Daily Mail, the CIA inadvertently, that's the getaway. That's the getaway car, the out clause. Inadvertently, it was a mistake. The CIA inadvertently gave a terrorist leader the finances and credibility he needed to mastermind a major attack, claims a former spy. Intelligence officer Morten Storm from Denmark was asked by the CIA to build a relationship with the head of the militant group Al-Shabaab, the group behind September's attack, and handed over money and equipment on behalf of Western intelligence agencies to cultivate the group's trust.
What they want us to believe, I'm guessing, is that, so the CIA have got loads of little guys all around the world, and women. They want us to believe that somebody says, so me and you are in the CIA, Richie, where's that document that you're handing? Don't know, Icke, I've not seen him for weeks. Well, he just blew up a hospital. And that's what they want us to believe, that there's that level of incompetence there, that they're managing guys and that they completely lose track of them and the money they've given them, and all of a sudden, oops.
Yes, and the pattern is so constant.
It can't be that stupid.
That obviously there's a much bigger story. And it's the same with bureaucratic incompetence. A lot of cold calculation is hidden by apparent bureaucratic incompetence, when actually there is bureaucratic incompetence, of course there is, but a lot of what is said to be is actually cold calculation, which, oh, look what they've done now, look at what the mess they've made. But actually behind the scenes, that mess is exactly what they want to achieve because of what the outcome of that mess is going to be.
some story that that guy got money from the CIA. I wasn't aware of that, that's the truth. Should be aware of it, but I wasn't aware of it. Moving on to this month again, big, big story this. You and I have been talking on the show when you do the papers with me. It's a Trans-Pacific Partnership and all this stuff. The 9th Ministerial Conference of the WTO, the World Trade Organization, delegates, they signed the Bali Package Agreement aimed at loosening global trade barriers. Sounds brilliant.
Free trade equals freedom to exploit. Freedom to crush the poorest, most vulnerable people in the world. The situation is that if you have trade barriers, so when you cross a border, then you have to pay a fee. That has to be reflected in the price of the product. So therefore, that helps industry in the country you're importing into have some kind of fair playing field or fairer. Once you remove trade barriers, it's just good for trade. It's not good for trade in terms of people. It's good for corporations because they can then make their products with slave labor in the poorest, most horrendously treated people in the world. And then they bring it across to the richer world without all these trade barriers and fees and stuff that they had before. And therefore, that's reflected in the price. And that can destroy the indigenous industry. That's what it's about. And of course, these trade agreements between countries also are being used to supersede national laws. So at least national laws, at least some of them anyway, have some kind of debate, however farcical, in Parliament. But these are superseding those laws decided in the parliaments and the congresses of the world in closed-door meetings between bureaucrats and insiders.
Yeah, how much a part did the Venezuelan government kicking out multinational companies, the Bolivian government kicking out multinational companies, taking oil fields and resources back, how much of a part did that play in these trade agreements that have been signed in the last few months? Had to have something to do with them, because one of the things that you just described it perfectly, one of the things that we've had people on from all over the political spectrum who've said, you know what, it's leaving sovereign nations, sovereign governments, exposed to being sued by corporations from another country.
This is exactly what they're
doing. Extraordinary, isn't it? And this is true. It's all happening.
They're having a situation where if countries refuse to let corporations do things which are very, very destructive for the home industry and the home economy and therefore the home population, but these trade agreements say they should be allowed to, then the corporation can sue the governments for actually making decisions within the borders of their own country. This is the global society I've been talking about all these years, this unified global society where governments are irrelevant. I mean, governments in Europe are almost irrelevant now. Is it 75% of laws that are imposed on British people actually start out with the bureaucrats in Brussels?
Yeah.
And the idea is that all laws set out from people in suits who've never seen a ballot box in their lives. Not that matters a lot in the systems we've got. But it's all about taking control of every aspect of people's lives from the people, from the alleged representatives of the people, and giving it to people who have no interest in the benefit of the population whatsoever. That's what these trade agreements are all about. They're not about people, they're about corporations.
And in the new year, I can promise that the people's voice will be speaking to people in favour of these agreements and people who are against them. And we'll be given both sides of that. It's a massive story, like David said. We're going to finish with two significant dates in November. The first one was the 10th of November, when we turn all the lights on here and did the five-hour show. And the second one, on November the 25th, the world's first publicly funded 24-hour a day, 7-day a week internet news and current affairs channel launched in London. And that's us.
Well, I've done a few things in my life here and there, but nothing has given me more satisfaction than this. Because what has happened in 2013 is that instead of this constant, incessant destruction and censorship of information, we've set something up here from an idea only in May that's been broadcasting 24 hours a day since November 25th across the great spectrum of subjects with information relating to all of them that you would never see in the mainstream media. Also, something else we set out to do, and you've done it brilliantly on your show, is we've taken mainstream people from mainstream politics and mainstream society and asked them the questions the mainstream won't ask them. And then you've got Sonia's show, 5 days a week, where she's giving voice to people who've never had access to the public before, who are doing amazing things trying to help people. And instead of, no one's listening to me, suddenly they're on the television. They're giving their websites. They're giving their contact details. And they're giving the information that they've had and had no vehicle for it before. It is extraordinary what's happened. And you know, when you get close to it, like we've been close to it, and every day you're doing it and doing it and doing it, you can get like that. But when you actually do that and you look what has been achieved with the people's voice in 2013, it is extraordinary, it is miraculous, it's incredible. And it is just amazing to show what you can do if you won't take no for an answer. Because what we've been doing since we went to air is we've been rolling back the suppression and censorship of information, not just holding the line, it back, and doing it in a credible way, which is saying to people we criticize, come on, you have a right to reply. Most of them don't want a right to reply because they don't want to debate something that they know they're going to be challenged in. But that come, we want everyone.
Do you remember what people said? Some people said, no, this is true. This sounds like a Fox News thing to say. Some people said, when really nobody said it. But people did say to us, you know what? You'll find some of the really, really eloquent and loquacious conspiracy theorists around the world and you'll put them on. You won't get mainstream people. And we could list the journalists, the senior political journalists we've had from The Independent, The Times, The Telegraph, New York Times, former ministers, current MPs, and that has staggered people. It's not staggered us. I mean, that was always the plan. Get everybody on.
You know, and when people say what you're having those people on for, you should be having people on that are challenging the system. Well, it's the people's voice, and the people is that happens to be all the people.
Regardless.
And it's very, very important that those that have driven the system in politics and corporations are questioned in a way they never have before to justify the way they've done that, to justify the way they're continuing to do that. So it's a two-way thing. It's not just challenging the system, it's saying to the system, justify yourself. Why do you do it this way? And it's been very, very enlightening. And you know, people don't come on here and get a hard time. They don't get treated with disrespectfully. And even if I don't agree with them or you don't agree with them, you treat them with respect. And people, therefore, will come on again and again.
Isn't it horrible that you have to almost not brag it, but we're not bragging about it, but it should be the way it is. I suppose we wouldn't exist if it was the way it is.
This is the big
this is the thing, isn't it?
This is the
it
biggest.
It should be the norm, huh?
What was
you got 30 seconds,
what
sir.
Was it Orwell said words to the effect of the truth being a revolution, telling the truth being a revolutionary act, or words to that effect. All we're doing on the People's Voice is what mainstream journalism should have been doing from the start. And if it had been, we wouldn't need to be here.
Talking
but unfortunately,
everybody.
We do, and fortunately, we are. And fortunately, we're going to continue to be.
Merry Christmas, mate.
You too, man.
Right, that's it for us. Thanks to all my team who put this show together. They're absolutely incredible people. They really are. I get to do the easy bit. Sonia Poulton is up live at 5, between 5 and 7. That's just over an hour. Don't miss her. She's got another array of brilliant guests. Topical debate and chat. I'll see you very soon. Have a lovely Christmas. Look after yourself. Bye for now. Bye now.